Thank you, Grégoire, and welcome to the API Platform Conference. So we will speak about PHP. As you know, API Platform is built in PHP for the server part, but also in various languages, including JavaScript for the full stack part of the framework, and especially for the front-end part of the framework. Today, this talk will focus on the server-side part. We will check the state of the PHP ecosystem, especially what is not going that well when you are installing and deploying PHP applications in production. Then I will introduce a new tool that I hope will help API platform projects, but also all projects built in PHP, even WordPress, to enter in the cloud-native era and to be easier to use, to deploy, to install locally, and faster than ever. After that, we will talk about the brand new version of API Platform, API Platform 3.2, that we just tagged as a beta version yesterday. And finally, we will see some upcoming other new features that we will release in the next few months. As you can see, the weather is rainy. Today, you will have the opportunity to drink strong beers in a bar. There is a Kévin on stage. Welcome to Lille. So let's speak about the state of the PHP ecosystem. Who is using PHP FPM to run its PHP project? Who is using it locally? Okay, who is not using API platform in the room? Okay, almost nobody. And who is using PHP FPM in production? Okay, we will see that most likely you are using PHP FPM even if you don't know it, because it's almost the only solution to execute your PHP applications currently, even on your local computer. So when you execute a PHP project, basically, your users will send HTTP requests to a web server, because a web browser is only able to speak HTTP. The web server, to support PHP, must have built-in support for a very old and weird protocol called FastCGI, the fast version of CGI, which is a very, very, very old protocol. And your web server, Nginx or Kdi or Apache, will convert the HTTP request in a FastCGI request. And it will call another server, the PHP FPM server, which is another program written in C that is listening on another port. The PHP FPM server will execute your PHP script or your PHP apps, your API platform app. To do that, it will use a pool of processes, of system processes, and the FastCGI request will be transformed again to as a set of super globals, the $get, $post variables, and as a set of streams like the PHP input stream. You will, at the end of your script, call the echo function or the echo keyword or the header function, and the PHP FPM server will create a fast CGI response that will be sent to the web server that will convert this fast CGI response in an HTTP response, and finally send it back to the user, to the web browser, to the web browser of the user. That means that unlike most other ecosystems, like Node.js, PHP doesn't speak HTTP directly. You need a third party. You need a web server, an extra component. When you are using, let's say, Next.js, there is a built-in HTTP server that is provided by the Node.js standard library, and so you have a standalone service. You just need one component, the Node.js server. In PHP, that's not possible if you are using PHP FPM. So you need the PHP FPM server, and you need a web server. Back in the days, it was easier, and it was possible to use a module for Apache. So basically, the Apache web server was able to directly execute PHP scripts. So it was simpler to install and deploy in production because you have a single program able to speak HTTP directly and to execute your PHP scripts directly. The problem is that currently, the stable version of the PHP module is not compatible with the engines of Nginx that are not marked as legacy. So basically, if you are using currently the PHP module for Apache, you are using a legacy engine because modern engines of Apache are using threads, and that's not totally supported by PHP. There is also an experimental module PHP for Apache that is compatible with threads, the ZTS thing, the ZTS build, but it is marked as experimental. It is not very stable yet, and it is not part of any distribution. If you install PHP with Debian, you are using the legacy Apache engine. So most likely, you are using FPM, and the PHP team usually recommend to use FPM even with Apache. So that means that locally and in production, you need a web server, you need PHP, you need two services with their specific configuration, and both components, both servers, need to talk together. To do that, you can use a TCP connection, a network connection, but it's not the best option. The best option, and it's what is done by default if you are using the API platform distribution, is to use a Unix socket between the web server and the PHP FPM server. If you are using a Unix socket, you have the best possible performance for PHP, but that means that both servers must be on the same physical machine and must share a file to communicate. So that's not that easy to configure, and that's even less easier to run in production. That also means that installing PHP projects, and that's a shame because PHP was the language where you were just putting some files using FTP on an OVH server and that was working. That's not the case anymore because of containerization, cloud platforms, and things like that. Now, if you clone on GitHub a PHP project, to execute it, you will have to install PHP FPM locally. You will have to install a web server. It can be, for instance, the Symfony CLI that includes a web server and will start PHP FPM under the hood, but it's still using PHP FPM. You need the exact same versions of both the PHP FPM server and the web server as your colleagues, or you will have strange bugs. You must have the exact same versions of everything as in production, or you will have strange bugs. And you must find the good configuration of both your web server and your PHP to have the things working, and you must be sure that you have the exact same configuration as your colleagues and as in production. So that's not very easy. Fortunately, there are projects helping to install PHP locally, especially using Docker. So if you are using API platform, everything is done for you, but still exists because we provide Docker files and Docker compose files to start all the services that are needed, provide the proper configuration, the good version, and things like that. There is also Symfony Docker, which is basically the same thing for Symfony. It has been extracted from the API platform distribution. And if you are using Laravel, there is a quite similar project called Laravel Sail that is using Docker to hide the complexity. Then you need, obviously, Docker locally. or Kubernetes, it's also an option to run your containers to start your PHP project. If you are using Docker or Kubernetes and you want a good performance, both locally or in production, you must have the server and the PHP, the web server and the PHP FPM server talking together, if possible, using a Unix socket, so a file. So the Docker best practices says that single image must have inside it a single service. Here, because of the design of PHP, we need at least two services, the web server and the PHP FPM server. So we need two images, at least two containers, and a Unix socket between both. But Docker provides isolation, so to share a file with isolation, we can do it. To do that, you must share a directory between the containers. That means that if you are working locally, it can be easy. You can use a Docker volume, and that works. It's what does the current version of the API platform distribution. But in production, especially if you are using Kubernetes, you must be sure that the web server and the PHP FPM server will be deployed on the same physical machine and on the same virtual machine, and you must configure weird options in the YAML files of Kubernetes to say, okay, both containers are tied together and must be deployed in the same pod, and then I want to create a shared directory. That's complex. If you want to deploy a JavaScript application in production, a Next.js application, for instance, you have a single service, a single image. If it's a small setup, a single container, you just put that in your cloud platform and that works. Unfortunately, that's not that simple with PHP. Another problem with PHP is still performance. The language itself is now very, very fast. According to some benchmarks, it's even faster than Python or Ruby. That means that if you are, let's say, writing a bubble sort or something like that, an algorithm, PHP will be very fast. But your production workloads are most likely web applications. And PHP is a web language. It has been designed for that. But it has, at its core, a concept that is a bit hurting performance. It's what we call fire and forget. Basically, that means that unlike most other programming languages used to write web applications, with PHP, when an HTTP request is received and then converted in a fast CGI request, etc., etc., your PHP script will be called. Your objects will be initialized. For instance, if you are using API platform, we will create a new Symfony kernel. We will create a new Symfony dependency injection container. We will create all the objects that you need that you will use as a service to handle the HTTP request. We will populate a lot of in-memory caches, static arrays with data. The HTTP request will be handled, and everything will be destroyed. And for the next request, we will have to build again the kernel, the dependency injection container, the services, populate the cache, and destroy it, and again, and again, and again, and again. And of course, that hurts performance, because if you are using, let's say, C or Java or Go or anything, you can do the work only one time and reuse the objects for every request. That also has benefits. The main benefit is that by doing so, you don't have to care about memory, and especially memory leaks. You can write code that is ugly, everything will be destroyed and reset after every HTTP request, so you don't have to be careful. It's useful to develop quickly. But if you have a high-traffic website, it will hurt performance. Another problem with the current state of the PHP ecosystem is real-time. In many modern web applications, you need the server to push new data in real time to the users. For instance, let's say that you are using Google Docs. When you are using Google Docs, you expect that in terms of user experience, you can see the other colleagues that are currently reading this document. And it's displayed in real time. You also want that when someone edits the document, you see the changes instantly. To do so, there is not many ways to do that. You must use one of the protocols doing to let the servers push data in real time to the clients. The web browsers are supporting WebSockets, server-side events, and it's experimental, but web transport, which is, let's say, WebSockets for HTTP3. This isn't very easy, and it's even almost impossible to implement these protocols using PHP, at least with PHP FPM. If you are using advanced things like React PHP or Swool, it can be done. But with PHP FPM, we have several problems for real time. The first one is that PHP has not been designed for long running connections. And by default, the connection will be closed after 30 seconds. So if you want a long-running connection to push some data using WebSockets, that's not possible. Another big problem is that because of the design of FPM, then a web server, then the web browser, there is no direct network connection between the web browser and the PHP server. There is an intermediate, there is the web server. So for many of these features, you must use lower-level layers of the network. For instance, to implement WebSocket or web transport, you must use, let's say, directly the TCP or the UDP connection if you are using HTTP3. But that's not possible with FPM because you don't have access to the TCP or UDP connection with the web browser, as it is handled by the web server, not by PHP FPM. This issue is also a problem with other new features of the web platform, including the 103 HTTP status code, which is a new status allowing to preload some files, usually your JavaScript or CSS assets, and improve by a factor by something like 30% the performance of usual web applications. To do so, you must also use low-level features of the HTTP protocol, and it's not possible with PHP FPM. So currently, it's not possible to use this with PHP FPM. Let's see how we can fix all these issues in one time. I'm very proud to introduce you the first stable version in beta of FrankenPHP. So FrankenPHP is a new application server designed from the ground up to fix all the issues that we have with PHP FPM. At its core, it's an all-in-one HTTP server that has native support for PHP. So basically, you will start a web server with that is supporting all the modern features of the web platform, including HTTP3, including HTTPS, etc., etc., and that can, as the old legacy Apache, execute directly your PHP scripts without relying on a third-party server like PHP FPM. Unlike Apache, Nginx, etc., it has been designed to be cloud-native. So it has been designed for Docker, it has been designed for containers. It is also configurable during runtime using a web API, so you can change the configuration of the web server itself just by calling a built-in web API. It has been designed for Docker, but also to ease the onboarding. And we are also distributing FrankenPHP as a static binary that contains everything that you need. We will see that in a few minutes to start a PHP project on your computer or in production. It has a worker mode that is entirely optional, that allows, with slight modification to your PHP applications and with no modifications at all to your API platform or PHP applications, to start one time, boot one time your application, and then reuse the kernel, the dependency injection container, etc., etc., to handle many HTTP requests. It has native support for real-time using the Mercure protocol, which is built on top of server-sent events. And at some point, it will probably get support for WebSockets and web transport. And it supports modern features of the HTTP protocol, including early hints. Basically, with FrankenPHP, you just have a single server. There is still the user's web browser. The web browser sends an HTTP request. FrankenPHP will parse this HTTP request and pass it to your PHP script, and it will use threads for that. Your PHP script will generate directly an HTTP response that will be sent directly to the web browser. So this time, there is a direct connection between the web browser and FrankenPHP. And the PHP scripts can be executed in the fire and forget mode. So that means that all existing PHP applications are already working with FrankenPHP. We are providing skeletons for WordPress, Drupal, and many other existing PHP projects that are supported by FrankenPHP. But you can also leverage the worker mode and improve by a factor 3 the performance of your applications if you do some quick modifications to be able to do the initialization work only one time when the web server will start, and then reuse the objects that can be reused across HTTP requests. So, of course, we don't have created everything from scratch. First, the PHP executor that is used to parse and run your PHP scripts is the official PHP code that you can find in PHP SRC on GitHub. So basically, we are embedding the official PHP interpreter, and we support all the features of PHP. It's not like Facebook's HHVM. This time, this is the true PHP, and you can use the just-in-time mode and almost everything that is supported natively. The web server is a custom build of Kadi, which is a very popular web server written on Go, and that has nice features like the support for modern HTTP versions, including HTTP 3, which is not supported by Apache and Nginx as far as I know, but that is supported by default by Google Chrome and Mozilla Firefox. So when you start a FrankenPHP project, and if you request your server using Chrome or Firefox, by default, without having to write a single line of configuration, you will get an HTTP 3 connection. Also, Kadi and FrankenPHP are able to manage automatically the HTTPS certificates. So when the server will start, it will, in production mode, it will automatically create a certificate using Let's Encrypt or Zero SSL, and it will renew the certificate automatically when it's necessary. If you start the server locally, you will have a self-signed certificate that will be generated for you. It's very, very easy to use. Basically, you just have to start the server, the FrankenPHP server, in the directory containing your PHP scripts, and that's all. The content of this directory will be exposed on localhost or on the server name that you will configure. And it is compatible with almost all existing PHP extensions, including opcache, but also Xdebug, that is shipped with API platform. We will talk a bit more about that. The easiest way to get started is to use Docker. And as you can see, you don't even need Docker Compose because there is only one service and one image. So here, you can run Docker run, mount the current directory as a shared directory with the FrankenPHP server, so the FrankenPHP server can execute your PHP script, and use the official image, and you get your application working with FrankenPHP. It works basically as PHP-S, but PHP-S is only for development. It is not threaded. It is not able to handle many requests. That can be used in production. The Docker images are built on top of the official PHP images, so you can use all the extensions and all the tweaks, all the configurations that you are familiar with if you are using official PHP images. By default, we are providing Debian images, but you can also use the Alpine variant if necessary, but currently not with IPA platform, unfortunately. If you don't like Docker, who is not using Docker on his local computer? Okay, some of you. Who is using Symfony CLI? Okay, some people. And who is not using Docker in production? Okay, still many people. Okay, if you don't like Docker, if you cannot use Docker, or if for any reason you don't want a container, we also provide static builds of FrankenPHP for Linux and macOS that you can download and execute, and they contain a web server, the PHP executor, and all the most popular PHP extensions. So it's the file is a bit heavy, but it contains Opcache and Redis and International and the MySQL and the SQLite extensions. Everything is built in. So basically, you download that, you type this command line, and you have a working environment. It works locally. It also works in production. Again, it's like PHP-S. It exposes the current directory. It has no dependencies at all. You don't need to install all the dependencies that you need when you install PHP locally. It's self-contained. And it works on Mac and Linux. This should be possible to have Windows support, but as I don't own a Windows box and I don't know Windows at all, feel free to contribute that. The worker mode now. So the worker mode is entirely optional. You don't have to use it. If for some reason it doesn't work for you, you don't have to use it. If you don't want to change your application because you will have to do some tiny modifications, it's not an issue. You will just not get the performance boost provided by the worker mode. So basically, this allows to start a set of PHP scripts as workers at the same time as the web server. This worker will be able to do to boot your application. For instance, you will be able to initialize your Symfony kernel, your services, your dependency injection container. And it will handle the incoming HTTP request thanks to a custom engine that we have created just for FrankenPHP that is written in a mixture of Go and C, and that are using the async engine of Go, the Go routine system, which is very, very fast and performant. So it's a bit a complex tech. I will not speak about the details and the internals during this talk, but you can take a look at the source code, of course, to see how it's done. According to our benchmarks that you can find on GitHub, by enabling the worker mode for API platform, the application is instantly more than 3 times faster for a hello world. And I'm not very proud of that, but the more ugly your application is, the more you have big constructors doing a lot of things that shouldn't be there, the more services you need, the bigger the performance boost is. If you have a vanilla PHP application, basically you will have to write the worker. This script will be executed at the moment when the web server will start. So basically, you will load the Composer Autoloader and you will create some objects that will be always reused for all requests. So here, I start, let's say, a Symfony kernel, and I boot the Symfony kernel. This will be done only one time when the web server will be started. Of course, you can start as many workers as you need. If you want to handle a lot of requests in parallel and you want to start 10 workers, you can start 10 times the same script. Then you create a kind of infinite loop, and you have a PHP function that is provided by FrankenPHP called FrankenPHP handle request. As parameter of this function, you must write a closure. And in this closure, every time the closure will be called, for every incoming HTTP request, the superglobals, get, post, cookie, etc., and the streams, like PHP input, will be reset. And after the HTTP request is handled and sent to the web browser, then we call the closure again to handle the next incoming HTTP request. If you are using Symfony or API platform, we provide a runtime for Symfony called FrankenPHP Symfony Runtime, if I remember correctly. And then you don't have to write that by yourself. It's provided by the runtime component and the extensions that you need of Symfony. And you just have to configure a single environment variable. And you get the worker mode for your Symfony or API platform application without having to change your code. And your code can also work with or without the worker mode, without having to maintain two different versions of your code. There is a native Mercure hub, so you don't have to install a separate Mercure hub as before. It's just built in FrankenPHP, so you have the slash well-known slash Mercure URLs where you can send post requests from your PHP application on localhost and dispatch events that will be received using server-sent events by the web browsers and that will trigger JavaScript events in the browser. I will not speak too much about that. You can find a lot of presentations about Mercure on YouTube and similar projects. And there is also native support for the new 103 status code, but this deserves a whole talk. It's already it's working, and you can use it right now, and it's documented on the website, but for today it will be too short. I will speak about this new HTTP status code and the improvements that it allows for your web applications, especially if you are using JavaScript and CSS at Forum PHP. So come to Forum PHP, it will be in French, to discover what you can do with the 103 status code and how to use it in PHP, especially with FrankenPHP. Until today, it was written in bold on the FrankenPHP GitHub page. Don't use it in production. It's not stable. That's not the case anymore. We have released FrankenPHP beta, and we are already using at Les-Tilleuls in production on some projects. And actually, the community is not reading the README file. And it has been downloaded a lot of time, and it's already used in production because sometimes I'm a bit quick to merge some new features. And I get very, very quickly bugs reports on GitHub saying, OK, you break my production, but it's written. Don't use it in production. OK, now you can use it in production. That's ready. And there is already a quite large community of users and contributors to FrankenPHP. Of course, it has been possible only because we are using a lot of existing free software. And to make this possible, we had to work on a lot of open source projects and to patch a lot of GitHub repositories, including PHP SRC, including Go itself to make it compatible with the virtual machine of PHP. On the static PHP CLI project, which is a very nice project, providing all the recipes that you need to compile a static build of PHP. So it's why we are able to provide standalone PHP, FrankenPHP binaries, and it's a very hard work that has been done by the community for this tool. We had to patch the Kadi web server itself too, and we had to at least to support the early ints 103 status code. We even had to add some modifications to Symfony. So it works now because of a lot of projects and a lot of contributions to the open source ecosystem. Still, we are at API Platform Conference, so let's talk a bit about API Platform. API Platform 3.2 beta has been released. You can start a new project as usual by downloading the release on the website or by using the GitHub template that we provide. So by running this first command line, you get a skeleton of an API Platform project with the Docker configuration to start it. Just run Docker compose up and you will get PHP and Postgres and Next.js container. API Platform 3.2 now comes with FrankenPHP by default. So when you download the API Platform distribution, you are starting FrankenPHP. And when you enable the production mode of API Platform or of Symfony by setting the app.env environment variable to prod, with the distribution, by default, it's using the worker mode, so you get the three-time boost in terms of performance. This change also allowed us to dramatically simplify the API Platform distribution because we have now only one service. We had the opportunity to remove a lot of Docker files and a lot of complex configuration to have the web server talking to the FPM server with volumes, etc., etc. And this works even on existing projects without having to change a single line of code. If you are not confident in FrankenPHP right now and want to use FPM, we still provide the FPM variant for now of the API Platform distribution. We also take the opportunity to rewrite entirely the Docker configuration to leverage the new features provided by Docker. And we manage to have 6 times faster builds, both when using PHP FPM and when using the FrankenPHP distribution. We also managed to use new features of the Docker BuildX engine to improve the performance when using especially GitHub Action. And we will see that in a few seconds. And everything is now easier to read and easier to maintain. So that's nice. If you upgrade the API Platform distribution to the latest version, you will get a significant performance boost if you are using GitHub Action. And you will probably save a lot of money if you are paying for GitHub Action. With API Platform 3.1, a hello world takes 7 minutes to build and to execute the test in GitHub Action. In API Platform 3.2, because we are leveraging the cache and we improved a lot of things, it just takes 1 minute. I published a long blog post explaining how it works on my blog. So if you want the details and if you want to improve your own GitHub Action pipelines to leverage the same hacks, just do it. In the meantime, if you are just using API Platform, be sure to upgrade the distribution by copying the new files because you will save a lot of time and a lot of money. Of course, there are many, many, many other new, very interesting features in API Platform 3.2. There is native support for OAuth and OpenID Connect, and Vincent will talk about that. There is a new website with a new documentation that is entirely runnable in the web browser. That means that now you can play with PHP and API Platform directly in your browser, and PHP will be executed in the browser thanks to WebAssembly. And you can try it right now, and Antoine will go in depth about how it works during his talk this afternoon. We improved a lot the DTO system and everything related to complex use cases, a bit, let's say, DDD-oriented and things like that. And Ryan will talk about that tomorrow morning. And we improved a lot of other things that will be covered during Antoine's talk. So what's next for FrankenPHP and API Platform? Some non-issues first. So if you want to contribute something, you can help right now. First, currently you cannot use PHP fibers with FrankenPHP because there is a compatibility problem between the Go runtime itself and fibers. We are working with the Go team to fix that. There are patches that are being written for Go, so we think that we will be able to fix that at some point, but that's currently not working. There is weird issues that we are still trying to identify with when using the Alpine Docker images of FrankenPHP with Symfony. So currently, you must use the Debian variants. And if you are using Doctrine, there can be some issues that are related to long-running connections with Doctrine. It also affects Roadrunner's full and things like that, and we are also trying to fix this. It's not a big issue because this will just restart the worker, but it will be better if it will not be necessary. FrankenPHP will also unlocks a lot of new use cases. For instance, I'm working on a prototype to be able to distribute PHP applications without having to share the source code of the PHP files themselves. And at SymfonyCon in Brussels, I will present a new tool built on top of FrankenPHP to create a single standalone binary that you can start and that contains a web server, PHP, but also your own PHP files. So just by downloading a single file, you will be able to distribute your application. Thank you very much. I hope that you will try FrankenPHP, give it a star on GitHub, and that it will not crash with a good old segmentation fault. And I don't know if we have time for questions, but
Thank you for this talk, Kevin. Big round of applause.